If you are not selling the impossible, you're selling a commodity product. You are selling an ordinary product at an ordinary price. You're not doing that, are you? Say no. No. What is selling the impossible? Maybe you have a fantastic product, a fantastic service that you're offering at a price that people say is too high. That's too doggone high. I'd have to be crazy, Jay, to pay you $45,000 a day, $5,000 an hour to chit-chat with me. You know what I call those people? The unwashed. I'm always excited to speak to Jay's group. I was told last night you guys are here from about 17 different countries. I'm going to do my best to make it worth your while to be here. And wasn't our previous speaker fantastic? Let's give him a big hand, ladies and gentlemen. Stephen M. R. Covey. And I noticed that a lot of you did not take any notes. Shame on you. Some of you are taking a bathroom break, which is well deserved. But get back in here, please, because I'm going to do something I've never done before. I've been privileged to be invited to speak at four or five of Jay's programs. Met incredible entrepreneurs, business people, and professionals from around the country. But I've never shared with them what I'm going to share with you in the next 5 minutes. And I promise you, if you take to heart what I'm going to say, you'll make an extra $1 million, maybe not over the next year, but over the next couple years. You want to know what I'm going to share with you? I'm going to share with you what Richard Bandler and John Grinder, two mentors of mine, call the structure of excellence. I've spent my career studying and working with some of the greatest presenters in the world, including Jay Abraham. And some of you did not take any notes. Maybe you thought that you knew all there was to know about trust. Or you think, don't we all think people trust me? They don't trust that guy I'm sitting next to, but they trust me. I'm Don. That's just natural, isn't it? But we can all get better at building trust. Unless every single person you meet says, here's my wallet, Chris. Take all the money you want. There's a blank check in there. Write it out for as much as you would like, Bali. I've done seminars in Bali, Indonesia. We can all get better at building trust. And you didn't take any notes. You were fascinated. You were entertained. I'm going to share with you the structure of how he did what he did. And the previous speakers and the speakers afterwards. You might think, I don't exactly need this. It's fascinating, but it's not for me. Study the structure of what they're doing. Because we can all get better at doing presentations, can't we? Say yes. Yeah. Put your hand on your heart right now and say, I can be a sales superstar.
I can be a sales superstar.
Now say it with even deeper feeling and passion. I can be a sales superstar. Doesn't that feel great? I'm calling today's program, How to Sell the Impossible. And if you think that Stephen M.R. Covey was not selling the impossible, try to sell a program on trust. I've written chapters on trust. I've written articles, cover stories in Psychology Today on the psychology of trust from an NLP, neuro-linguistic programming breakthrough perspective. There are dozens of books that have been written about that subject. He has an impossible task, and he did it masterfully. He might make $25,000, $35,000, $45,000, $50,000 per speech, and he deserves every penny and more because he does it so well. Let's look at how he did it, because there's something that every one of you in this room, there are about a dozen things you can learn from his talk and from other people's talks. How many of you here do any form of sales or marketing? Raise your hand. I see almost all your hands go up, and some of you whose hands were not up, they should have been up. You're too tired, maybe. I don't know what the... You need another cup of Starbucks back there. But folks, he started with humor. I've met about 35, 36, 37 of you here today. These wonderful people. No one made me laugh. Only a few of you made me smile. Think about that. He started with humor. He talked about Jay's introduction. Remember what he said? He said, that was a great introduction, Jay. My father would have been impressed by it. My mother would have believed it. And he talked about how great it was to stay at the Bonaventure Hotel. He said the way you measure the quality of a great hotel is by the thickness of their towels. And the way I know this is a great, great hotel is that I could only fit one towel into my luggage. And you all laughed. Write this down in your notes. On the last page, I have a blank page for bonus ideas, million-dollar bonus ideas. If at all possible, start with humor. Write this down. Humor disarms people. We all like to feel good, don't we? Say yes. Yeah. People, when they first hear you, I don't care if you're selling computer products, nutritional products, investment products, real estate, there's a natural level of distrust. I call it the shield of resistance. You get people to laugh a little, they will drop that shield. They will become less defended. Are you good at resisting good feelings? I hope you're not. Because if you spent 10 years studying to get a PhD in psychology like I did, you learn something. It's very advanced. There's a technical term psychologists use for people who are good at not feeling good, who are skilled at not feeling good. They're called psychologically screwed up. And I know that's not true for any of you in this room. You're healthy people. So he started with humor. He ended with humor. Write that down in your notes. End with humor. Leave them feeling good. He had Saturday Night clip. You were all laughing. He ended with humor piece after humor piece after humor piece. You might have thought that was fluff. It had a very important point. And I'll bet you if I went through most of your presentations and your PowerPoints, there would not be very much humor in them. Get people feeling good. And then he segued into stories. I counted over 20 stories. He used story on top of story on top of story. Not every presenter here has been doing that. I noticed you were more engaged with our last presenter than some of the earlier ones. Not to criticize them. They did a masterful job in their own way. But write this down in your bonus ideas. Stories are one of the most powerful persuasion devices ever invented. How did Jesus teach? With parables and metaphors. Every great religious leader in the world has used parables and metaphors and word pictures. So can you. Every great religious leader and every great politician and great parents use stories. Stories are more effective for teaching your children than lectures are. And a lot of you here that I've met today, you wonderful people, you're just using facts. I said, what do you do? What do you sell? What do you promote? What do you market? Fact, 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 which is good, but it's boring. And you know, your real estate facts didn't sound very much different from the other guy's real estate facts I had lunch with. Let me share a couple of more techniques he used with you. He built the need. Write this down. He spent about 20 minutes in the presentation. He got to the solutions at the end, building the need, showing you statistic after statistic. High schools that don't have trust, they have lower graduation rates. Kids get lower test scores. Businesses that have lower trust, they earn less profits. Remember all those statistics? He was building the need. What I call this is you find the pain. Write that down in your notes. Find the pain. The metaphor I use is you find the bullet hole. Someone's been shot in the arm with a bullet, and you stick your finger in it, and you wiggle it around and say, does this hurt? Does this hurt? Does this hurt? Would you like a Band-Aid? Would you like me to clean that out and heal it? I work with one of the most successful financial planners in the country, and after we build the need, and you can do this in a funny way. After we build the need, we say, folks, do you know what time it is? People say, it's 3:35. No. He says, you know what time it is? It's time to stop the bleeding and start the healing. You want to heal your portfolio? You want to get back those tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, maybe $1 million your broker lost you? That's why I'm here. It's time to stop the bleeding and start the healing. And then he goes into his presentation. So he built the need to show you why you need trust. And then at the very end, he gave you some solutions woven in with many, many more stories. There were 6 other techniques he used, but I don't want to take the time to go through them. This is the structure of magic. And even if there are later presenters, you might think, I don't need internet marketing, I don't need this. Jay has the highest standards of anyone in selecting his speakers. Study the structure of what they're doing, because every speaker, I don't care what his or her topic is, you can learn from the structure of what they do, the structure of their mastery. I've been traveling, and on Friday I'm traveling to Texas to work with one of my wonderful clients named Phil Wasserman. Some of you know. He's the number one annuity producer in the country. He's in the top 10 life insurance salesmen now. I've been helping him for about 7 years with his presentations. And you know, the remarkable thing is that a lot of these superstars started off just like you. Some of them started off lower than you. They were in positions where they were really struggling. I've been honored to also work, Jay didn't mention this, but with the Trump Organization. And you know, folks, there was a time when Donald Trump, everyone calls him a billionaire now, he's a billionaire. In the early 1990s, he was a negative billionaire. His net worth, did you know this? Was a negative $1 billion when New York real estate crashed. Whose was? Well, what they told me is negative $1 billion, but that's either way, it's a huge number. It's a staggering number. Look at the comeback he made. So late last night, I'm working on my presentation to give you guys the most powerful knowledge I can share with you, and I'm looking at this fantastic list of speakers. Jay, he brings in the best of the best. One of them, Laurel Langmire. I'm honored. She's a client of mine. As great as she is, folks, she actually says, I don't know if it's true or not, that I helped her become better. And last year, she deserved every penny, but she made over $20 million. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that, yeah, she deserves every penny. John Ashroff, another wonderful, wonderful client of mine, this, one of the stars of The Secret. Tomorrow, you're going to hear from Fran Tarkington. Spike and Jay and I did an incredible program for him about a year and a half ago. And in addition to setting all sorts of football records, many of which are still around, still in existence, no one's beaten those records, he has an insurance agency on the side. It's called an IMO, Insurance Marketing Organization. And over about 10 or 12 years, he's built up 400 great agents in that. And I wrote a few articles about Fran that appeared in the premier financial advisory website, Morningstar. And I generated over 1,000 leads that of agents that were motivated to come over, switch their allegiance to Fran. Now, he didn't sign up all of those. But that's just one of the things that Jay and Spike and I did. Write this down in your notes. Writing articles is one of the most powerful forms of selling of all. I call it invisible selling. It's a script. Articles are a script. Now, you have to educate people. It can't be fluff. You can't just beat your chest and say, Bally is the greatest. My products are the greatest. You have to educate people. But I've helped many of my clients write articles and write books, and that has brought in more money than paid advertising. I have never paid for an ad in my life. I never will. Nothing wrong with that. As Jerry Steinfeld would say, nothing wrong with that. I don't think Jay Abraham has ever paid for an ad in his life because it's so easy in this day and age to get massive amounts of free publicity. If you just do these, practice these techniques and analyze how the other speakers use these techniques, you can make $1 million to $2 million a year. And folks, take notes, maybe not on their content, but you should never let 2 hours go by like you did with our previous speaker, not taking notes. Study the structure of their magic, okay? Let's jump into today's program, Selling the Impossible. I personally think, I've been doing a lot of thinking about this lately, I think this is the most honorable form of selling of all. If you are not selling the impossible, you're selling a commodity product. You are selling an ordinary product at an ordinary price. You're not doing that, are you? Say no. No. What is selling the impossible? Maybe you have a fantastic product, a fantastic service that you're offering at a price that people say is too high. That's too doggone high. I'd have to be crazy, Jay, to pay you $45,000 a day, $5,000 an hour to chit-chat with me. You know what I call those people? The unwashed. These are the people who say your product is too expensive, your service is too expensive. They are ignorant. It's not their fault. They just don't know enough about the incredible benefits of your product or service. You are selling the impossible. Are you selling a brand new product no one has heard of, or brand new service no one's heard of? I've met people in Jay's programs in the past who are doing that. A gentleman selling fortune cookies in more flavors and more colors with more different kinds of fortunes inside than anyone has ever imagined. I've met people selling a beeswax product that was totally revolutionary, and people selling all clothing lines from London. People came to my other seminars that were revolutionary. Spar's paintings, if you look at Spar's paintings, this room is naked without Spar's paintings. How many of you have seen Spar's paintings and his artwork and his sculptures, which have been purchased by Ted Turner, soon to be purchased by Oprah? She doesn't know that yet, but we're working on something. And purchased by many, John Denver, many, many other celebrities. They are life transforming. You are selling the impossible. I want to show you how to do that. I want to help you do that. Because almost all of the progress in this world, as far as I can tell, especially in business and marketing, comes from people like you who are selling the impossible. People who are selling commodity products, ordinary products at ordinary prices, good for them. They keep Walmart going, but they're not really changing. They're not leading the breakthroughs in our society. Let's look at who some of these people are who have sold the impossible. I'm going to share with you a few case studies from my clients to show you how average people, and you guys aren't average, but I'll show you how average people and above average people can sell the impossible and make this a better world and, of course, make a ton of money. There's nothing wrong with that. As Gordon Gekko said, greed is good. A little bit of greed never hurt anyone. So look at Christopher Columbus. I was thinking about him. Someone just triggered that earlier speaker, triggered my memory of Christopher Columbus. People say he's a great navigator. Folks, he was not a great navigator. He was 5,000 miles off course. He was looking for India, a shortcut to India. He went the wrong direction. Other people had the idea of sailing across the Atlantic, but they couldn't convince the people with the money, Queen Isabella and other people, to ante up the bucks. He was a better salesman. He was selling the impossible. And aren't you glad he got funded with the Nina Pinson Santa Maria and came over here? Look at Ted Turner. He was selling the impossible. He went to all the major networks and said, I've got this great idea. I have this brilliant idea. 24-hour news. It's never off. You get to watch news 24 hours a day. They said, Ted, you're insane. What have you been smoking? What have you been drinking? We have the news on from 7 o'clock to 7:30. We can't get people to watch it. You think you're going to get people to watch news 24 hours a day? But he persisted. He was selling the impossible, and he's a billionaire as a result. You know, I do a lot of traveling. My idea of home cooking is room service. And, you know, folks, when I get into a hotel, one of the first things I do when I turn on the television, are you like me? Are you like me, folks? I turn on to CNN. I don't want to watch the local news station, hear about the PTA meeting, or hear about a fender bender down on Main and Broadway, you know, in this town. So he was selling the impossible. Put your hand on your heart and say, I can sell the impossible. Now say it one more time with even more feeling and passion. Really believe it. I can sell the impossible. I want you to think of an impossible dream. Think of how much you sold or your company sold last year or marketed. Some people are actually uncomfortable with that word sold and selling. If I had more time, I'd do some therapy with those people. But think of what you sold in your best year. And put your hand on your heart one more time. I want you to anchor this in and say, I can double that. Now say it with even more passion. I can double my best year's sales. Double my best year's sales. Folks, you have to sell yourself first. As you know, people say I'm an expert on scripting, on the words we use. Write this down in your bonus ideas at the end. The most important person to sell is to sell yourself. If you haven't sold yourself first on you and your products and services, how can you sell anyone else? You can't. Okay, let's jump right into today's program. You should all have a copy of this. And we're going to go through this very quickly. We're not going to have a chance to get through all of them, but you're very, very smart people. I've met a lot of you and some of you at previous programs. I met a gentleman here who was actually at one of my programs with Charles Givens 15 years ago. Where are you? You're Ken? Ken, all right. What a great student. And Chuck Givens is a guy who I don't think even graduated from high school, a brilliant guy, who when I was working with him and training wonderful people like Ken, he had about 45 people that I trained to do seminars around the country. He was doing seminars in 40 or so major cities. And of course, he wrote the book Wealth Without Risk, which was a national bestseller. But at the time I was working with him, Forbes magazine did an article on this guy who used to be a land salesman, and his net worth was estimated over $200 million, which people said was impossible for a guy who never even graduated from high school. Okay, let's look at the question. You know, people call me the doc. I actually have a legitimate PhD in psychology. Everyone talks about the psychology of selling, psychology of trust, psychology of this and that, but the interesting thing, they don't have a PhD, and I think I have a few extra insights because of that. Maybe not too many, but a few that will help you. Why aren't you selling more? The first thing a doctor does is diagnosis. You have to diagnose the problem. There's really only four answers to this question. Number one, your products are inferior. Is anyone here selling an inferior product? Do not raise your hand. I started to see a couple hands go up. No, I know that's not true. And folks, if you are, this is not the program for you. You need to be in Jay's Advanced Product Improvement Breakthroughs course, which is $50,000, and that will be in June. Number two, you have bad service. You are wonderful people. You're very attentive. You don't have bad service. That's not a problem. Number three, another reason you might have lousy sales, you're unskilled in your profession. You're unskilled in medicine, law, financial planning, or your business. That's not true. You couldn't afford the tuition to come here if you were unskilled. So do you think it might be that your advertising, marketing, underline the word sales, are not as effective as they could be? Yeah. That's what it is for most of you. Your products can get a little bit better. Your services can be a little better. But you know, folks, one of the things I've learned over the last 25 years of doing this is that frequently, it's unfair, but I have to be honest with you, the people who have the best products don't necessarily sell the most. Have you noticed that? It was widely believed that Betamax was superior to VHS in the video wars, but they lost. Couldn't sell it quite as well. Now, we had that latest battle between Blu-ray and what was the other one? HD. So it's not always that the best wins, but the people who market the best, who sell the best, win. In a court of justice, I've been studying super attorneys. I've worked with a couple super attorneys. And it's not always that the guilty are found guilty. If you study the work of Jerry Spence, who's been undefeated since 1968. He defended Imelda Marcos, who he admitted. Imelda and her husband took $2 billion from the Philippine Treasury. It was an impossible case. He got them off. He won the case against Kerr McGee, Karen Silkwood, plutonium poisoning case. People said it was impossible to sue this big company and win. He won the impossible. You want to study master salesmanship, study Jerry Spence. He's written a couple of brilliant books. No one in your business is doing this kind of reading. They're just reading 100 power closing techniques. They're reading the same old 30-year-old stuff that doesn't work anymore. And you wonder, why am I not selling more?